also give an added welcome to the visitors. If you're visiting here today, the Lord has sent you to the right place, and we really want to welcome you in a very special way. A young lady came up to me and she told me that, "I remember you. Your daughter and I are good friends." And I don't know if this is her first time here, but we want to welcome you as you worship here with us today. One last thing I would like to say before we go to our scripture, and that is we, in our work bee tomorrow, I promise to be here. And I'd like to see some of our able men, because I learned that we have some gutters to clean tomorrow. And if you can bring your ladder with you, do that too, so that we can do the Lord's work together. I'm so grateful for those who have consented to help, and God will bless you and give you that special blessing. Our scripture reading is in the book of Mark, Mark 2, the gospel according to St. Mark 2. And if you would stand with me so that we can do this scripture together, and we will do it responsively. That means I do the first, you do the second, up until 12 verse. At the 12th verse, we'll all do it together. And that is Mark 2. And again, he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." "Why does this man speak blasphemy like this? Who can forgive sins but God only?" "Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Arise, take up your bed and walk?'" "I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go your way to your house." Together, immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them, so that all were amazed, saying, "We never saw anything like this." Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, again we approach your throne, and as we open your words, speak to us. As I open my mouth, speak to me, for me, and through me. We want to thank you for this worship service today. We want to thank you for sending Janice here as a new member. And we pray that as she prepares to be used by you, that you will give her the strength and the power to be witnesses for you. Thank you for blessing us with this worship service. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 The primary privilege and responsibility of a Christian church is to share the gospel of Jesus. And the church should not or must not forget this. While Jesus was here on earth with his disciples, he taught them many things. And one of the things that Jesus taught his disciples was to be witnesses, to preach the gospel. A matter of fact, before he leaves, he gave them a command. And the command is found in the gospel according to St. Matthew, Matthew 28. In verse 18, it says, and these words were coming from Jesus Christ himself. In verse 8, it says, all power is given unto me. Jesus said to the disciples that he, Jesus, had the power. Would you like to have some power? I don't know about you, but I'd like to have some power. But the power that I would like to have should be coming directly from Jesus Christ himself. And so Jesus said to the disciples, all power is given unto me. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. He said, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost. Teach them to observe all things, he said, and lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. In other words, Jesus is saying to us that we shouldn't keep quiet. That reminds me of a story that you might have heard. I do attend a minister's convention and workshop every year in December. And one of our keynote speakers told us a story about his mother, who was 82 years old at the time, and it was her birthday, and he had to leave to a speaking appointment. He hated to go on his mother's birthday, to go away from her, and he didn't know exactly what to give his mother or send his mother, so he decided to send his mother a bird for her birthday. An exotic bird. A bird that speaks 7 different languages. So she received the bird, and a couple days later he called his mother and he said, Mom, how do you like the bird? She said, son, he was delicious. But Mom, you shouldn't have eaten that bird. The bird speaks 7 different languages. Well, son, he should have spoke up. The moral of the story is that this bird spoke 7 different languages, and he didn't speak up. You and I have the gospel in our hands. You and I have been equipped with the words of God. You and I are a beast with the three angels' message. And the command from God is that we speak up. And don't be quiet and be excited about telling others about Jesus Christ and his coming. I look at this scripture in Mark chapter 2, and I'd like to go back to verses 1 through 4. Again, he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. I'd like to remind you this morning that Jesus is in the house. Jesus is in this place. Immediately, many gathered together, verse 2, so there was no longer room to receive him, not even near the door. And he did what? He preached the word to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken through, they let him down. They let the bed on which the paralytic was laying. I'm always blessed and amazed by the profoundness, the power, and the clarity of the words of God. There is something about the words of God. I get excited when I have to not only preach, but study the words of God. There are sometimes that there are things in the scripture that grabs your attention. People were always, I learned from the scripture, that people were always attracted to Jesus. And wherever Jesus was, they traveled long distance to be where Jesus was. But in this case, Jesus dealt with the sin problem of the paralytic before any other. The question is, how did the paralytic get to Jesus? The house was crowded. There are many individuals in the house, and there weren't room enough for people to get around. And here it is, there were four men outside. I don't know if they were related, were from the same town, or they even knew each other. But they had the same purpose. This man needed the Lord. This man needed to be healed. This man needed to be close to Jesus. And these men, for some reason, whether they had a committee meeting or whether they talked about it before, I don't know. But I believe that the Spirit of God got into these three men and unite them as one. You see, working together, you get the job done better. And God wants to unite us. Ellicott City, if there ever a time we need to work together and pray together and love each other, is now. And I'm pleading with you, please let go of your agenda and let Jesus' agenda take precedent in your lives. Because God has great plans for this church. And I believe it with all my heart. That's the reason why we established this 30 days of prayer, praying together and let Jesus Christ take over. And if Jesus is in control, my dear brothers and sisters and friends, the work will get done. I believe Jesus was in the house, and these four men believe in Jesus. Maybe they were physically ill also. Maybe they needed to be healed. But their attention was focused on this paralytic man. And I believe as they got together and worked together and were determined that they would get this man down from the roof, by the roof, into the house, they were doing that because of the love that they have in their hearts for the work that needs to be done. The big question is, what is it that led this amazing miracle? The big question is, what is the story, trying to get these pages together, what is the story of the man called paralytic? How did he get in touch with Christ? And more importantly, who took him? The scripture states that the four men took him. Now, who were these four men? Please note, we don't know their names. It hasn't been recorded in scripture. We don't know their background, where, what town they were coming from. We didn't know their educational standing. We don't often preach about them or teach about them or sing about them. However, there are some valuable lessons to be learned from these four men. At times, I wonder who gave them permission to remove the roof. I didn't find the answer in scripture. I often wonder whose house was it? Did any of those four own the house? I don't know. And I don't think you know either. But what I know, that these four men, their hope was to see this one man get well. Inspiration tells us that this paralytic man, he lost all hope of recovery. His disease was a result of a life of sin, and his suffering was embittered by remorse. This man was physically helpless. I believe that he was also spiritually helpless. He was abandoned, I believe, by his family. And I think because of his illness, he was disfellowshipped by the church, rejected by community, scorned by his wife, and ostracized by society. Bad news for him. According to the Pharisees, he was left to die. But here it is, four men decide that we won't allow this man to die because of his disease. We will take him to the person who can heal him. And that's right. Jesus is also a healer. And if you go to him sincerely, he will heal you. And he was taken to Jesus by these four men. I'd like for us to look at four lessons that we learn from these four men. And lesson number one is that we cannot make impact without making contact. And these four men were determined that they would make contact with this one man so that he can see Jesus. To reach people, we like these four men and Jesus must be willing to break down barriers. Yes. Barriers of prejudice. Barriers that you and I hold holy, and we need to let them go. Jesus was willing to do that. In searching for lessons from this text, I looked at John chapter 4, and this is your assignment when you go home to read John chapter 4. In St. John chapter 4, Jesus was on his way to Galilee. And while Jesus was on his way to Galilee, I believe the Spirit of God came to him and said, Jesus, you must go through Samaria. Because he had other routes that he could take to Galilee. And in chapter 4 of John, it tells us that Jesus went through Samaria. Why? Because Jesus had a mission in Samaria. You see, Jesus listens to his Father. And as his Father speaks to him, he obeys his Father. And you and I sometimes need to take time to listen to that still small voice, because sometimes that still small voice is telling us what to do and we go against the small voice. And that small voice is God himself. And Jesus listened, and as Jesus went to Jacob's well, Jesus saw a woman of Samaria. And in seeing the woman of Samaria, Jesus asked her for a drink of water. But Jesus had no business talking to her because he was a Jew. But Jesus had a mission. And sometimes, friend, we do have a mission. And we blow it and block our blessings because we want to go contrary to the will of God. But when God speaks to us, we need to answer him and we need to obey his will and not my will or your will. And I believe God is talking to some of us right here in this room, and we have a mission where we need to go and do. Maybe it's a Bible study, maybe it's feeding someone. I don't know what it is, but God is talking to us today. And just as how he spoke to the four men and they obeyed, he is speaking to us, Ellicott City, and we need to listen to the voice of God. The memory text that we have for next week, it said, let your light so shine among men so that they will see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And I believe that if we put a bushel over the lamp, it will not shine. But I believe if we take the light and light our community in our where we live, it will make a difference. So Jesus listened to the voice of God, and God sent him through Samaria. And the woman who he witnessed to, she went back to the village, and she brought the whole village. Isn't that wonderful? She brought the whole village to Jesus. And Jesus was able to minister to them because that was his mission. These four men, their mission was to save. And not only that, Jesus was breaking down prejudice barriers. And there are some barriers that stand in the way of us witnessing. And if Jesus is speaking to us, and I'm talking about barriers of race and gender and territory and conduct, Break those barriers down. But the only way we can break those barriers down, Jesus must in the heart make an impact. We must make contact to make impact, and we must break the barriers of prejudice down. And there are people in our community, yes, there are drug addicts around us and alcoholics and people whose lifestyles are different than yours and mine. They are uneducated and adulterers and fornicators. They are out there, but they need you, and we should not step aside from it, because if God calls us to go and preach the gospel, we should not have any barriers. Go and preach as Jesus did. Zacchaeus was in the town of Jericho. Have mercy, Lord. People didn't like Zacchaeus because he stole their money from them. Zacchaeus wasn't the kind of person that they want to keep company with. But Zacchaeus heard about Jesus, you see. And as he heard about Jesus, he wanted to see Jesus. And Zacchaeus was a little man. And it was a big crowd. So Zacchaeus thought he would climb up into the sycamore tree. I believe that sycamore tree is still there. Hundreds of years old. My wife and I had the privilege of visiting Jericho, and they showed us the tree. They told us that's the same tree. We don't know whether it's true or not, but we had to believe it. And Zacchaeus was up in the tree. Jesus was down the road, and people were following him. And Jesus came by the tree. And you see, Jesus didn't stop by the tree. Jesus didn't pass the tree. He stopped. And he didn't only stop, but he knew that there is a mission for him. So he looked up. And he saw Zacchaeus. And he said to Zacchaeus, come down. Oh my. Zacchaeus couldn't believe that the Jesus, whom he wanted to have a glimpse of, told him to come down because he wants to be in his house. You see, Jesus is not prejudiced. Jesus, in spite of Zacchaeus and his behavior, Jesus wanted to teach Zacchaeus salvation. And Zacchaeus came down very fast. Although people were upset with Jesus, Jesus and Zacchaeus went home together. And Jesus had a one-to-one. Can you imagine the Bible study that Jesus was giving? Can you imagine how excited they were together? And at that time, Zacchaeus was converted. Because Jesus himself taught him how to love. Jesus taught him how to forgive. Jesus taught him how to return what he has taken away from the people in Jericho. Jesus changed the life of Zacchaeus. Do you believe he can change your life? My brothers and sisters, I believe in all my heart that when I have a walk and a talk with Jesus, I won't be the same. You see, inspiration tells us that Jesus mingled and he socialized and he won the confidence of the people. They learned to love him, and then he said to them, follow me. Oh my, wouldn't you follow Jesus? Yes, yes. The next point I have here lessoned from them is winning souls to Christ is not done in isolation. Thank you, sister, for saying amen. Because Jesus called the disciples two by two in Mark 6 and verse 7. He called the 12 and he sent them out two by two. Jesus is saying to us, find a partner. You may not be able to give the Bible study, but you can pray. You may not be able to pray, but you can give the Bible study. You may not be able to do any of those, but you are there in the midst and allow the Spirit of God to work in and through you. Every Christian is called by God, appointed by God, anointed by God, and committed by God. And no wonder, he says, all power is given unto you. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Evangelism is a team ministry. And as we work as a team, as we are united, and this is happening here in this church, whether you believe it or not. And if you're not a part of it, you need to find the group and be a part of it. You can recall when the disciples went up into the upper room. And the disciples were of one accord, and the Holy Spirit came down upon them, and they did great things for the Lord. Evangelism called for many things. It called for wisdom. Wise man Solomon said that he that winneth soul is wise. It calls for preparation. We need to take time and prepare ourselves so that God can use us for his glory. It calls for selflessness. These four men weren't thinking about themselves. They were thinking about how they could get this man to Jesus. And number three, winning souls or evangelism called for ordinary men with extraordinary faith. It's only when you have faith in Jesus you are able to win souls for the kingdom of God. These men were ordinary men with extraordinary faith. They had faith in the paralytic, that God was able. They have faith and they believe that this paralytic man would cooperate with them. They have faith in each other. They have faith in themselves that God was able to work through them if they decided to allow him to use them. Yes, we serve the God who was able to forgive, he was able to restore, and he was able to empower these men. Now, how did they demonstrate their faith? These men demonstrate their faith against the odds. Their family, society, and community. This was something strange they were doing. How in the world you come to take somebody's roof off their house? But they believe in Jesus, and they believe that if they trust in Jesus, Jesus would help them. So they follow Jesus. Today, I must say to you that their faith, the faith of the four men, God responded to their faith Number one, to break down barriers. Faith that broke walls down. Faith that broke obstacles down. Faith that broke misconception down. And they did have extraordinary faith. In closing, God is calling us as Christians, and I'm using the word Christians instead of members. Christians are people who accept Christ as their personal savior from sin. Christians are people who let go of themselves. Christians are people who are connected to God and have a relationship with God. And it doesn't matter what the consequence may be, you're determined to be faithful to God to do His will. So, God calls us as Christians to be soul winners. If you're a teacher, teaching is your profession. Soul winning is your calling. Believe that, my brothers and sisters. If you're a nurse, nursing is your profession. But soul winning is your business. You are in this Christian thing not for you to sit back and be comfortable and come to church and somebody preach to you or teach to you, but you are in it as you accept Jesus and to ask Him to help you to be a part of this mission. If you're a pastor, pastoring is your profession, but soul winning is your business. Remember, you can't make impact without contact. God uses ordinary men for extraordinary faith, with extraordinary faith. Yes, God does not always call the equipped, but He equips all who He calls. God does not always focus on our ability as much as our availability. God always uses the ordinary in the extraordinary way. And God is calling you today to answer the call to be a volunteer to win others to Christ.